Hi everyone, Dennis Foley from Acoustic Fields. Today we're going to look at some of the questions and comments we get in our inbox. I think this is number 5 in the series. There's a lot of confusion between absorption and barrier technology. I don't know why that is, but there seems to be. A barrier is just that. If you have a noise source, someone yelling, okay, here on the outside of your room, and you're on the inside of your room, the quickest way to stop that noise from getting into the room is to construct a barrier. So a barrier is a boundary surface between a noise source and a receiver. So this is the source, and this is the receiver, okay? So the quickest way is to build a barrier between the source and the receiver. Now, when you build your barrier between the source and the receiver, then you use sound absorption technology on the inside of the room, okay? That's the big difference. So absorption is an inside treatment for reflections and all the issues that go on inside the room. You don't use absorption as a barrier, and we get a lot of that. Well, I've got some foam, and my neighbor's playing drums. I'm going to put some foam, and that'll stop the drum sound from coming into my room. So you have to be really careful about what you're doing here with the term. So absorption is a technology you use to lower reflections, minimize pressure within a room. A barrier is a technology that you use to isolate yourself and others from noise issues, okay? Here's another one we get a lot of questions about, and I don't know why, because it's not really that popular anymore, and it's very expensive and not really used in studios today. But angled or splayed sidewalls. Well, we know from our two-channel setup that we have a left and a right speaker. Well, the thinking is, if you angle the sidewalls, that you reduce the reflections at the listening position because the angles send the reflections behind the listening position. So what angle do you use? Well, it depends. Depends on usage, depends on distance from speaker to listening position, depends on listening position to the rear wall, depends on size and volume. And those of you that are in construction, building a wall that has a 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 degree angle on both sides, be very expensive. We don't use any of that in our construction. We stay with a rectangular room because a rectangular room is predictable and consistent with its low frequency issues, with its middle and high frequency issues, and more importantly, with its treatment issues. So with that predictability and consistency, you don't really need this because we have the technology today to minimize reflections, and we don't have to spend the extra money. I would rather see you spend the money that you save by not doing angled or splayed walls on the treatment side of the room, okay? Structural versus airborne energy, big issue here. Structural is energy, vibrational acoustic, energy that, airborne energy that's hit a structure, like our barrier here. We have a person yelling and it hits the barrier. So it starts the barrier moving. Okay, and this movement has a particular frequency response, okay? And the frequency response of this noise determines how thick and what materials you use in the barrier and how quiet you want to make this. So if you want to make it quiet, maybe we have to be thicker. Maybe not. Just depends on the frequency and the strength of all that energy. So structural energy is energy that strikes a structure and gets the structure moving. Like your speaker cabinet, a subwoofer, the cabinet is poorly designed. The driver goes back and forth, the cabinet makes more sound than the driver. So you have to be careful there. Airborne energy is energy that goes through the air. So you have airborne here first, then it strikes the barrier and becomes structural. The goal is not to allow the structural to produce noise on the inside and become airborne energy on the inside. So two different approaches, two different ways to look at energy. There's some overlap in the disciplines, but the key to the application of those is in the differences between the two. That's how you be successful with it. Vocal room size, volume, usage. How many people are we going to put in our vocal room? How big does it have to be? It's a big difference between one person, two people, and three people in a room. So you have to be very, very careful and choose the right volume depending on the number of people that you're going to put in the room. And use diffusion and absorption in your vocal rooms. That's a great way to get great sounding vocals that have lots of air, lots of liveliness, lots of separation and definition and realism, and not this boxy feeling that you get, you know, with some vocal rooms where everything is just centered and closed and there's no air or anything in the presentation, okay? Had a lot of calls from noise, people that are having noise. Have a client has a machine shop 150 feet away from his house. It's producing structural vibrations. As these presses go up and down and slam, then you have the machine shop here and the house here. And it's producing all this energy through the ground and traveling into the house. So what do we got to do? We got to build a barrier to block that. Okay. How big is the barrier? How deep? How thick? It depends on the frequency and the strength of the signal. We don't want to build any more than we have to because it's expensive, but obviously we don't want to make it thinner than we need to because then we'll still have the issue. So those are some of the questions we get in our inbox. Hope they've been helpful to you. Thank you. I hope you enjoyed our videos today, and if you did, we really would appreciate a thumbs up from you. If you have any questions or comments, you can go to the comment section, or you can go to our website, acousticfields.com, and fill out the contact form. Subscribe to our channel, our YouTube channel. We're now doing 2 videos a week. If you have some ideas for topics, you can submit those to us also. If you're having room issues, we have that free room analysis. You can click on the button below, and we'll compare your room to our database of 120 built rooms that we built and actually measured, and I guarantee you your room is in that database. So just click on the button below for the free room analysis. Thank you.